I'm going to touch on a different topic. I'm going to talk about the digital student a little bit and some of the issues I see that we as educators are going to face as the digital student starts to get more access to information. Okay. What do I need to do?
You're the person.
Turn off the speaker.
Turn off which one?
Turn the mic on. Turn the speaker up on the
On the Mac. Okay. Okay. All right, so you may recognize this person here. He's not here this week, but just in case, let me put it in context here. So there's me with him. But this is my colleague, Muhammad, from my college. And I want to prefix this presentation. I'm going to talk a lot about teaching with technology and social media. And before I do that, I want to just highlight Muhammad here. So Muhammad sent me a message one time where basically, if I can translate, he said, don't read my blog because I don't have one. Don't bother looking for me in Facebook because I'm not there. Right? And I don't have any followers in Twitter because I don't have an account. Right? So the point of all this is that those are all great tools, but them in themselves are not going to make you a great teacher. And so Muhammad is a fantastic teacher who engages his students with just a traditional classroom lecture. He uses PowerPoint, he uses technology, uses the Cisco curriculum, but again, he's a great teacher just in his own right. And I think that's true of everyone in this room. But what I'm talking about is trying to use these tools as a value add to try to engage our students better. All right, so a couple stories here and then a quiz. Gordon was going to give you that test with that grid he showed. But here, this is, I have a colleague whose son was at an academic bowl. He's a high school kid, and he's not the brightest kid in his class. There are other students that get better grades, but he got invited to participate. And so one of the questions for this academic bowl was, who was the wealthiest family in Florence during the Renaissance? And so all of the other students didn't get this, but this kid, Jeff is his name, he got the right answer. Anybody know the right answer? The Medici family, all right? So why did Jeff know this answer, but nobody else know?
He watches HBO.
He plays Assassin's Creed, all right? So he learned this from playing the game Assassin's Creed. So that's the first thing there. All right. Now, here I was teaching my Juniper class one night, and we were I was talking to the students about a summer offering that we were having. And so my wife and daughter decide they're going to order a pizza. So they're asking if I want the regular pizza that I like. I like beef, onions, and extra sauce. All right. So then I respond back, EMC, right, which is the company that makes the storage technology that we were teaching in the summer. And my wife says, huh? And I say, sure. So what happened here was I was talking to a student and trying to text at the same time. All right, so I can't do that. All right, and that's, my daughter figured that's what it was. All right, this last quiz here is what do these four things have in common? We have a calculator, we have an iPod, four-color Bic pen, you remember those pens? And then an old Nokia phone. All obsolete. Well, they've all been banned in the classroom at some point. So you can go back and find it. Arizona, there was a district that banned iPods because a kid was using it. He had downloaded all those Schoolhouse Rocks videos on there and was using that to learn math, and they banned it from the classroom. The four-color pen, grade school teachers used to grade in different colors, and so the students would change the grades. Yeah. All right. So the takeaways here are: kids can learn from games. I can't multitask, and technology is scary. All right. So this raises a lot of questions, and I'll try to answer some of these questions in this talk. And also give some possible solutions that I see. And by the way, this is a word cloud site called Tagcedo. So T-A-G, it's like tuxedo, but tag. And allows you to upload a shape, and then you can take a group of words and make a word cloud that fills that shape. So again, it's a very engaging way to teach, because if you have a particular shape that's related to what you're teaching, then put the keywords in there, and maybe you don't have 40 slides discussing it, you just have one slide. All right, a little bit about faculty versus students, and I might need the sound for this, let's see. All right, so I want to phrase this in the idea of experts versus amateurs. We like to think of ourselves as the experts and the students are the amateurs, so if experts versus amateurs becomes faculty versus students.
And this one I've titled Tree.
Can you tell me what f-stop you had the aperture set to?
Pretty big.
Exquisite. And the shutter speed?
Really quick.
How did you compensate for the diminished light?
Very well, thank you.
All right, so the point of that, it's a funny video, but the point is that the cameras have become so sophisticated that basically anybody can take professional-looking photographs, and you're seeing that with Flickr, a lot of these photo-sharing sites, and that's what the technology is doing with our students in some degree. It's enabling them, right? So what's happening now is that gap between faculty and students is starting to close, and that's one of the issues that I think that we have to be concerned about. All right. This is another, some of you may have seen this before, just a quick series of videos, again, comparing faculty and students. So the first part is faculty.
Whoa, that's not good.
Oh, I don't need this. I'm already late.
Somebody will come. Anybody out there?
Do you have a phone?
No. Sorry. Somebody! Hello! There are two people stuck on an escalator and we need help. Now, would somebody please do something? Believe this.
So it's getting dark. They've been sitting here for a long time, stuck on this escalator, and as you would expect, they call the help desk, and so the someone from the help desk, our IT person, comes.
Hello. Hey, don't worry about it. I'll fix it in a second.
He said he can fix it. All right. That's more like it. He says he can fix it.
All right, so unfortunately he's stuck now too. But I want to compare that with how our students view technology. So where there are a lot of faculty who are afraid of technology and a little have trepidation in terms of embracing technology, our students embrace the technology and they even come up with new ways to use it. I haven't tried that myself, but the little Westfield Mall here, if you have time between the presentations, maybe you want to give that a shot. But here's a quick little video showing how many faculty view students.
This is the end of publishing and books are dead and boring. No longer can it be said that we like to read. My friends and I, we don't like the way books feel in our hands. It's not true that I don't follow trends. I know what I want when I see it, and packaging is more important than content. I have to tell you, my attention span is too small for big ideas. And it's just not true that I read a lot and I like learning. I don't care. And you should never think I've got to be concerned with environment and sustainability. What I really hope you get is you've got to open your eyes to my values. What's important to me is what Lady Gaga is wearing, and I don't really care all that much what Gandhi did last century. I think it's unbelievable that you're actually listening to us. What's important for you is you'll find customers for your products. You think your job's done if we like your brand. We'll do it for you on Facebook, on our mobiles, me and my friends. Your market is dying. Don't think it's all going to survive. It is the end of the publishing industry as we know it.
All right, so that was done by the publishing industry. So, but if we take that now and how instead, and again, I know a lot of faculty in my institution that view students that way. They think the students have gotten lazy, they don't want to do the work, they fall asleep in class, stereotype you want to say about students. But I think the students have a lot more potential than we give them credit for. It's just we've lost sort of the idea of how to engage them. So this, if we take that whole thing and sort of flip it or reverse it, here's what happens.
Unless you reverse how you see me. It is going to survive. Don't think that it's all dying. Your market is me and my friends. On our mobiles, on Facebook, we'll do it for you. If we like your brand, your job's done. You'll think of products for your customers. You'll find what's important for you is that you're actually listening to us. I think it's unbelievable what Gandhi did last century. And I don't really care all that much what Lady Gaga is wearing. What's important to me is you've got to open your eyes to my values. What I really hope you get is I've got to be concerned with environment and sustainability. And you should never think I don't care. I read a lot and I like learning. And it's just not true that my attention span is too small for big ideas. I have to tell you, content is more important than packaging. I know what I want when I see it and I don't follow trends. It's not true that we don't like the way books feel in our hands. My friends and I, we like to read. No longer can it be said that books are dead and boring and this is the end of publishing.
But reverse that now and look at how many students view faculty and you'll see why we have a tough time engaging them.
Hi.
You know, if we had that FedEx office printer presentation, they could have shipped it too. Saved ourselves a hassle.
I'm not too sure about this.
Right. Never kick off with sales figures.
Kicking off with sales figures.
I'm yawning. I'm yawning some more. And...
I see your point.
Yeah. So... keep that in the back of your head about your students. I'm yawning some more. All right. So now a little aside here, this is an educational conference and a little bit of educational psychology, and Carl was talking yesterday about Maslow's hierarchy. So this is Maslow's hierarchy here, and this is on index cards. So there's a site, index.com, where the blogger basically creates these nice little index cards here, but this is Maslow's hierarchy of hats. Okay, so first we have psychological needs, so they're hairnets and stocking caps. All right. Then we have safety needs, so helmets, and if you're afraid of aliens, tinfoil caps. Then we have belonging needs, hats with logos. All right, so. San Francisco Giants, I guess, around here. Self-esteem needs, so tiaras, dunce caps. And then finally, self-actualization of eccentric and velvety hats. Okay. And where we want students, well, unfortunately, this is where we want students. And I don't think it's working out so well. I look at that model as this is sort of a 19th century model of education, and we haven't changed it a whole lot. I love this slide because I just wonder, is it a graduate student who comes in with a ladder and gets all that up on the board? And this is what you end up seeing. You see the students sort of self-selecting where they're going to sit. You have those ones in front. Thank you, Gordon. And then you have the ones that are sort of sitting by the exit, the ones that are leaning against the wall and don't want to be bothered. And you see this with faculty, too. Faculty, even at faculty meetings, I like to sit by the exit.
And what we need is this statement.
I was just copying that kind of thing.
Figure out how to mute your sound.
It doesn't do that. I'll just download the attachments.
See what's going on here?
All right. So that's a bit absurd, but that really is what's going on in the classrooms. I mean, they're coming in there with just a 20th century typewriter, which is a computer, but we're not really changing what they're doing in the classroom there. All right, and the other place we're trying to get them is we're trying to get them into our e-management or our learning management systems, Blackboard, Angel, Desire to Learn, whatever it is. We're also trying to engage them with e-books and having some success with that, but again, it's a struggle. Right. And where students are? Well, a couple years ago there was a presenter from Apple out here, and he mentioned that they did a study where they were finding that students were consuming 20 hours of digital media, whether it's video, audio, text messaging, cell phones, 20 hours a day. And you say, well, how can they do that? They sleep, you know, teenagers sleep like, 16 hours. Well, they're doing that in 7 hours, so they're multitasking, right? Which is, I guess Paula Velluto was talking about, encouraging kids to become thumb surgeons because their thumbs are going to need surgery as they go later on in life. But I think this is what's going to happen: is the whole morphology is going to change, where they become even better multitaskers. All right, a couple. Data points here. This is a study Gordon shared with me a few years ago. So this is an old study now. So this is the data is probably even higher now. But this was incoming Emory University freshmen. So this was before they'd even come to the college. 90% of them already had a Facebook account, and more than 30% of them checked their Facebook at least 18 times a day. And I'm assuming that's going to be higher now. So how many of you teach an online or a web-enhanced course, right? How many of you have students who check their course 18 times a day? All right. It's 18 times a semester. Okay, a couple of them. Okay. All right, so that's something we got to look at. And I also think the idea of a newspaper here, so what's the average age for a regular newspaper reader? 55, right? That's not our target audience. And then how many in five people under the age of 25 ever reads a newspaper?
One.
One in five, right? So I've got a few USA Todays piled up in my hotel room that I haven't had a chance to look at, but the kids aren't gonna look at them. All right. So Facebook is playing a big role, and I encourage you, if you haven't had a chance, the London School of Business and Finance, right, they have a Facebook app. So a Facebook app is, again, something that's coded and written into Facebook. You can like their Facebook app, but it's their global MBA program. So it's videos, quizzes, tests, everything that they have for their global MBA program for free. And if a student pursues all that, they can come and take the certification at the London School of Business and Finance and get the credits, but they're basically putting it out there for free. So it's very well done. If you can't find it, send me a note and I'll send you a link. Right? And in terms of the mobile web, you notice these kids, you know, if you have trouble figuring out how to adjust the volume on your laptop, what do? You call your teenager over and they can fix it for you. And that's where things have gone, where the technology is so intuitive that the kids just pick it up and know how to use it. And if you think of some of the earlier technology, I mean, I've been at faculty meetings where a dean's presenting and they're trying to, in Windows, trying to get that little, the audio icon and mute the audio or raise the volume. I've even seen deans that don't know how to start PowerPoint, and then they're just scrolling through the slides in the editing mode. Okay, we have deans who don't know what a PowerPoint is. We'll come back to deans. Okay. All right. And here, this is traffic just from my site, and this is a related to a Gartner forecast here. So Gartner said that web browsing is going to be dominant on mobile devices by 2013. And I think that's probably accelerating. And Gordon talked a little bit about what some of that is happening. But you see already there, this was last spring at my college. So already you were seeing number 7 and 8 for web traffic for our college site was mobile devices. And our website's not even optimized for mobile. The college doesn't even see that on the radar screen in terms of what they need to prepare for. And this is, again, how young kids are getting cell phones now. So the hot hot Christmas gift for kids was either the Microsoft Kinect, they all wanted that, those were hard to get, or the iPod Touch. A lot of kids wanted the iPod Touch. But you see that more and more children are getting cell phones at younger and younger ages, so they're going to be immersed in this technology before we even see them. Right? And this is a little story I linked to in my blog where this guy gave his 3-year-old his iPhone, his old iPhone, to play with, and now he can't get it away from her. And that's all she does, is she wants to be on the iPhone all the time. And Gordon talked about this a little bit, and I think in terms of where things are heading, mobile is where the growth is. Right? All the fixed and the landline stuff is static. Everything is going to be mobile, and that's going to be global, and it's going to be in this country. Gordon and I have talked about it. I probably will never buy another desktop computer. Again, why would you buy a desktop? You can do everything you need to do on a laptop computer, and then you can unplug it and take it with you if you need to. Yeah. All right, some of the barriers here. All right, this is the first one here, and unfortunately, we're the barrier in some cases. So this was a graduate program at a university where the students wanted to create a repository where they could put up their research findings and share their research sort of in an open courseware sort of model. And what stopped it was not the school, it was the faculty. The faculty weren't comfortable with the students sharing their work with each other. This is a engineering student from Canada. I won't name the school, it's in the text there if you can see it. But he was taking the first freshman chemistry course. And he created a Facebook group where the students could share information back and forth and help each other study for the weekly quizzes that they had. And the professor found out about this and brought him up on academic integrity charges. So the end result, there were a lot of outcry about it nationwide and in Canada, but the professor wouldn't back down, so this kid was facing 147 academic integrity charges, and it's because of the number of students that were in the Facebook group, so it was very popular. But he ended up, he didn't get suspended, but he's got a permanent mark on his transcript now that he violated their academic integrity code. And to me, what he did was the old study hall. That was the little common area where you get together and study. And the professor said, well, no, this is cheating. You know, he's cheating. And again, when you're looking to hire, we have people from industry here, when you're looking to hire somebody, this is the kid you want. This is the kid that can do something, that can set up a group like this and get something accomplished with his peers. All right, and other barriers are the students themselves. They're constantly distracted. They honestly think that we can't see them under the table with their cell phones texting. Right? But we see that. Also, you know, there are some issues with addiction to this technology and to the internet. So that's my friend's son Jeff, the gamer. All right. And even the carriers, Gordon talked about 4G. This is a blogger who I follow recently did some analysis, and he looked at the data speeds for 4G. And so we're moving toward this ubiquitous wireless, we're gonna have all this beautiful high-speed data, but the carriers are capping the data. So in this case, it's capped at 5 gigabytes. And what he looked at is if you have the maximum speed, how fast am I gonna consume that 5 gigabytes? That's a month of data that you have. So 32 minutes running at the highest possible speed, you would consume your whole monthly quota. Right. So even if you were doing Netflix in standard, if you run Netflix for 7 hours and 24 minutes, you've consumed your whole 5 gigabytes. So even though the content is out there now, the carriers are actually putting up barriers, and they're going to hit you hard if you go over that cap. It's like the old days when you paid per minutes for texting. Right. And obviously time is an issue. Okay.
Kill the feedback a little bit.
Okay, thank you.
How's that?
That's good. Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
I'll just have to talk louder. All right, this is my schedule for the spring, tentatively yet. It still has to be approved by the dean. We'll come back to the deans. I like your comment about the deans. But I'm teaching, I'm department chair, and then I'm teaching 6 classes, and it's 6 different classes. So I have 6 different preps. All right. And physics is outside of my department, so that doesn't, to her, that's not a class. So if I didn't have another class on that day that I have physics, she would say, well, you have a 3-day schedule. You need to put something in your schedule. All right. So again, backward thinking in terms of how faculty are treated at our institutions. All right. The amount of new technical information. Okay. Another quiz here. My father was a PhD in civil engineering, and he was born in Afghanistan, so we went back to Afghanistan, and I was born there. And we came back after being there 8 years. And I said, why don't you go back into, you know, a university and work in a university? And at the time, in the 70s, he said, well, the amount of information in my field is doubling every 10 years, so basically I'm all the way back at the beginning now. I can't really go into academia and do any kind of credible research. And what's happening now is that amount of information is doubling every 2 years. Right? So we teach 2-year programs. So if we're teaching them 2 years of content and then they get out of the program and that content now is doubled, right? Well, it's obsolescence. They have to come back and take more classes. And I know Bill Sachek, he has a whole group that does that. They never leave. I think 7 years, he told me, he's got students that have been there 7 years. All right. Well, good. All right. All right. And another obstacle is the amount of information that's out there. And what happens is, initially, the more information you get, it's better, your confusion goes down, but then you get information overload, and that's what some of these kids are suffering from. And I myself am suffering from it, and it becomes hard for them to focus. Okay. And you get slides like this, where you know, this is they kidnapped their professor and they want their life back. All right, now on to deans. All right, so let's talk a little bit about deans. I planted him in the audience, by the way. All right. So that's, we all know good deans and bad deans. And you can recognize a good dean right away and you recognize a bad dean right away. All right, so one of the things that I talk about on my campus is this culture of nah, all right, the culture of nah. So I say, well, I want to go to this conference. And so what's the response? I want some new equipment. You you want me to develop this program, I'd like some release time. And that's an obstacle that we all face on our campuses. And another obstacle is, especially when we move in this direction, is the haves and the have-nots. We all have students in our classes who have wonderful access to resources. They come in with their little netbooks or their laptops. They all have their smartphones, but then you have other students who don't have access to that. And so we do have to be concerned about that and make sure that we don't disenfranchise those students. Some potential solutions here. The first thing I want to do is talk about Daniel Pink, used to be a speechwriter for Al Gore. His most recent book is Drive. And in Drive, what he's doing is talking about motivation and what motivates us. And let's see, it's a little dark there. But he's come up with this concept of motivation 3.0. And again, it goes back to this Maslow's hierarchy. The students don't have really needs that are unmet anymore. So the things that used to motivate somebody to do something don't work anymore. So we have to look at a new model of motivation. And he comes up with these three pieces for motivation 3.0 is we want to encourage them to get mastery in it. So if we want them to learn something, we want to give them mastery. We want to give them purpose and context. So there's a purpose to what you're doing. We're not just here to learn this table of 20 wireless standards that Gordon put up. There's a purpose to learning those. What that is, I'm not sure. And then finally,
get your stipend.
There you go. See, purpose. And then finally, autonomy. And that's one of the missing pieces here. Is you have to give them some freedom to let them take some control of their learning. Because if we spoon feed them like we have been doing, a lot of people have been doing for years, they graduate. They're gonna go and they're gonna say, well, tell me what I'm supposed to do. Tell me how I'm supposed to do this. All right, give them some autonomy, the ability to develop mastery, and some purpose. All right. So we have the pessimists, we have the optimists. So the pessimist sees the glass pessimist is half empty. The optimist is half full. We're technologists and engineers. We're technologists and engineers. We see the glass as always full. It's half full with water, half full with air. All right. There are also some political solutions, all right? And Gordon talked a little bit about those, and I'm trying to get Gordon to run for governor in Massachusetts, but he doesn't want to do it. All right, so this is a quote here. So basically, the technological revolution is intertwined every day with our economy, our society. More than 50% of our gross national product comes from information-based industries. Most political leaders today have no background in that revolution. Everyone agree with that? That's a pretty strong statement. Okay. It's going to become crucial that the larger decisions we make, how we allocate resources, how we educate our children, needs to be made with an understanding of the technical issues and the directions technology is taking. And that hasn't begun yet. Great quote, right? Who do you think said this?
Benjamin Franklin.
That's cool. No, it wasn't Benjamin Franklin. All right. Anybody else?
Einstein.
Well, this was Steve Jobs in 1985. So 1985 he was saying this, and I don't think the situation has changed in the 25 years since then. Okay. I read it for the articles. Okay. All right. Now, another possible solution here, you have means, you have motive, and opportunity. This is from the crime dramas that I watch all the time. But if you have the means to do something and you have the motive, the desire to do it, then you have to wait. All right? You can't get it done. If instead you have the means and the opportunity but not the motive, then it's really just an accident. It just happened by accident. If you have the motive and the opportunity but you don't have the resources, you don't have the means to do it, then you're angry. All right? And a lot of places with limited resources, that's what's going on. And then finally, where we need to get is in that center of this Venn diagram here, to D, And if you're in D, then it's serendipity. And that's where you have the means, you have the motive, and then you also take the opportunity. You have to be prepared for that opportunity. And I've talked with Pierre a lot about the NSF and funding, and Pierre is a big believer in serendipity, that he wanted to do it, he had the means to do it here, but then he grabbed that opportunity and took it to get the NSF funding to make MPICT happen. Okay? This is...
I'm an environment farmer. I've been practicing network learning in my 7th grade science class. I spent some time at the beginning of the year learning how to find information online and how to pull it all together on a personal page. As you can see, there's lots of stuff here. Some things, like my Facebook account and the blocks across the top, are not for school. I organized all my schoolwork along the bottom row. Every morning, when I come to class, I visit the science agenda to see what we're doing for the day. Sometimes there are videos to watch or other work to do. Other times, I decide what I need to work on next. One day, we played a game called Pocket Tanks, and I used it to learn how to write an official scientific report. That was created on my Google Docs account and published for anyone to see.
Okay, I'll stop that. But that is a seventh grader, and that's what she, you missed the beginning because the volume wasn't up, but that's her personal learning environment. And so this idea of a personal learning network, a personal learning environment, is again, I think, something we need to explore in education. And the rest of the video, she talks about what tool it is they're using to build that. But we need to build that ourselves, and that's not only at our own institutions, but through this network of people here you meet at this conference, you build your professional learning network. So you have Gordon to reach out to. You say, Gordon, you mentioned something about LTE. Could you tell me more about LTE? Send me some information on LTE. So you want to build that professional learning network and then also encourage your students to do that. They do it informally. If you, we have a bunch of students from AT&T, so they do it informally. They all know who knows what, and when they work in AT&T, they know who to contact if they have a particular type of problem, but we need to encourage students to do that in school and then out of school. All right. So this is traditionally what we do in terms of our learning network, so we're sort of stuck with our curriculum, our colleagues, the popular media, print and digital resources, and then our local community and family. That's a typical teacher network. And if we limit ourselves to that, we're missing out then on this whole world of other information that's available, and that's why I want you to sort of explore that idea of building your personal learning network. All right, open courseware is another opportunity. I'll quickly go through this, but MIT's open courseware initiative. Initially, MIT was worried that this was gonna cannibalize their enrollment if they just put all their curriculum up there for free. But what happened instead is it's generated more interest in MIT because people can see the quality of the content and they're getting more applications than ever. All right. Yale has a similar initiative. There's an open learning initiative at Carnegie Mellon. There are a bunch of tools online that can make you smarter. YouTube has a .edu portal where you can get educational content. Open source online textbooks is another interesting idea here. This question is going to come up when you talk about this sort of open courseware and open textbooks. Is the academic credit worth the money? If I'm interested in learning to program in Python, if I can find a bunch of YouTube videos to learn how to program in Python and figure it out through those YouTube videos or a course at Yale, do I need to go and take a course for credit? Is an employer going to care if I have that credit, or is it more important that I know how to program in Python and can demonstrate that competency? So that's a challenge that we're going to face. The distributed university, this is an interesting idea where they're talking about this idea of being able to build a course by just putting in some keywords and then having it sort of crawl the web and build resources. So build a custom course by just finding YouTube videos, videos from other sites, PDF documents, Word documents, and actually build a course that's distributed across the whole web. Gaming, excuse me. Carl Kopp talks a lot, and he did a presentation last year that focused on gaming. I think gaming is huge, and you saw at the beginning, I talked about the kid that could learn from gaming. But I think we need to look at, seriously at gaming in education, and maybe you don't call it gaming. Maybe you have to use a different term to get it through the curriculum committee. But if you look at the percent of U.S. households that play video games, 65%, so it's pervasive. 2 out of 5 gamers are female, all right? So again, it gives us a much better ratio than we have in our current classes. The average age, 32 years old, but you look at the distribution, it's all over the place. They're under 18, they're between 18 and 49, and there's a significant 26% that are over 50. All right, we talked about checking Facebook 18 times a day. Well, the average gamer will spend 18 hours per week playing their video games. So if we can take 30% of that, take a fraction of that and make that educational gaming, then we've accomplished something. All right? And the goal here is to make learning fun, I hope. All right? So rather than if they get some enjoyment out of it, hopefully the frequency of consumption will go up, and we sort of have to have that balance between it becoming work and it becoming enjoyment. All right, and so I showed you the videos with the escalator. So this is sort of imagine a future where instead of this idea of the faculty on the escalator and the students spinning around on the escalator, what if we redesigned everything to something like this? What that tells me is that if we modify our systems, we can change behavior. And so that's what we got to look at. It's changing our system, changing the way we do things. All right. So e-books is another one. Digital textbooks, still 70% of the textbook sales that are at the college or at bookstores and their websites. And this was last spring. Only 3% of textbook sales were e-texts. And you're seeing some issues with e-texts in terms of people with disabilities. And a pilot at Princeton, the students were not happy about the Kindle pilot there. But Texas and California are both doing e-book mandates, and so those are in the pipeline or already happening. So it's coming, and we have to embrace it. So this is the iBooks. And lastly, information here. We need to look at, this is David Dalrymple from the MIT Media Lab, look at filtering rather than remembering. Information now is not stored and retrieved by people, but it's basically on the internet, managed externally. You're going to have ability for your students to talk and hear people from around the world. And all of these new digital media literacy skills are going to require us to come up with new ways to measure it. So the way of whether we can measure whether a student learns, those are going to have to change as well. All right? So I'll stop here. I'm probably right at the time limit here, but I'll take some time for questions. Yes?
So what does this mean for the process of individual assessment for student learning objectives?
Well, I don't think we have, Gordon and I are working on some rubrics for social media, and we're looking at some ways to try to assess those, but I think it's such an emerging area now that we don't know. There was a presentation on e-portfolios I attended yesterday, so that's one possibility where a student collects the kind of digital media work that they're doing and puts it together as an e-portfolio. But if they're posting stuff in Facebook and they're doing stuff on Twitter and it's distributed like that, it becomes even more difficult.
My job is to prove to the curriculum committee and enrollment management that student actually did that work.
Right. Right. Well, I mean, at some point, you may still have to rely on the traditional assessment tools that we use, but we're going to have to, you know, look in the future at moving to different means of assessment. Yeah, back there.
The technology is allowing us to be able to collect and analyze much more effectively. Mm-hmm.
I agree.
Can you repeat the comment?
Deb Beauvoir said that she thinks that technology is gonna help us to do some of the assessment. So we're gonna be able to use technology to come up with new ways of assessing this. Let me get his question. I'll come back to you. Yes.
I'd like to recommend to you and others the PBS Frontline series from last February, Digital Nations. Mm-hmm. She's from a different perspective. Mm-hmm. I have my students watching with paper on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen that. It's very good. He's recommending a PBS series from last year called Digital Nation, and he has his students watch that and write a paper on it. Write a paper? Oh, my God. Yeah. All right. Yes. Okay.
A quick comment for context is that Western Governors University is approaching that problem by having sent out 20,000 microphone webcam sets to their students for use with two-factor authentication for local taking of assessment.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Other questions? Yes.
Now, just to back up what Deb was talking about, one example of early assessment, you know, one of the biggest problems we find is that students don't know how to take notes.
Mm-hmm.
So just the use of, you know, something like Google Docs or Zoho, you can actually see what students are taking notes in within class, gives you much earlier and better ability to find out what they're focusing on, what they're learning, and so on. In some cases, for the first time, someone actually
Right. Yeah, that's a great comment. John is commenting that students don't know how to take notes, and using technology to collect their notes and being able to view their notes is a great tool. And again, I agree, John. It's something we don't teach how to take notes. We just assume they come in and know how to take notes. I'm being cut off here, but thank you, everybody. I'll be here if you want to talk some more.